Hello and welcome to Game Creators Vault. My name is Anders Hallman, and today we will be interviewing Chris Avellone, the creative director of Obsidian Entertainment. Nice to have you on the show today, Chris.
Thanks for having me, Anders.
Chris has worked on projects such as Planescape Torment, Knights of the Old Republic 2, and Icewind Dale. So, Chris, what was your role in the production of, of Fallout New Vegas and its DLC?
We had a lot of history with Fallout from back at Black Isle to Interplay. A number of us worked on Fallout 2 back in that studio. And then when the option came up from Bethesda, hey, would you guys want to do the next iteration after Fallout 3? They said, well, you know what? See where you can take the franchise, use the existing engine. And then we set about just creating New Vegas and going, you know what? What would the Mojave Wasteland be like in this post-apocalyptic environment? And then we just had a lot of fun from there.
And so, what was your average day, kind of working on that project as a, you know, as a project director and designer?
I actually came through onto New Vegas about halfway through its production. The actual project director, Josh Sawyer, was overseeing the whole project from beginning to end. My role in the project was mostly with regards to narrative design. I wrote a lot of the major characters, like one of the end bosses, Legatlanius, I wrote. Also a companion, Rose of Sharon Cassidy. And I also helped flesh out some of the areas in the actual game. Like they have a Mojave outpost in the southwest section of the game. And what I would do is take all the characters there and their quests, make sure those were working properly, set up a scripting for that, and also sort of give each character a little bit of individual life. So that was kind of the typical day for me. Mm-hmm.
And so how did you make sure that you communicated your ideas to an entire team of designers, artists, and programmers? And how did that vision kind of, that shared vision, come through?
It's kind of a long involved process, and I'll just run through the basic steps. On New Vegas, Josh Sawyer set up a series of region design documents, which sort of gave the overview of the region, some of the major characters, and then that's usually passed off to the actual area designer that ends up fleshing out the rest of that in its entirety. When it came to the New Vegas DLCs, however, what we decided to do was actually do a three-stage process. The first step was, because each of the DLCs is sort of its own self-contained adventure, we would actually pitch the idea to Bethesda and say, hey, do you agree with the overall, you know, high-level theme of this? Does the actual, you know, summary of the adventure sound good to you? So, like, for example, for our first DLC, Dead Money, we sent them like a one-paragraph description of, hey, you know, we want to do a 200-year-old casino heist, you know, mm-hmm. that finally reaches its, you know, conclusion in the Mojave Wasteland. And they're like, okay, well, you know, that sounds like a pretty good premise. You know, there's a few things we don't want you to touch about the area or the storyline, but otherwise the overall direction seems good. What we do after that is, once we have the actual theme and sort of like the overall adventure arc laid down, we'd actually have sort of a group conversation with all the leads on the project and go, hey, you know what, does this seem like it fits in with our resources, with our scope? You know, do you guys have any elements that you think would be fun to throw in here? Any specific weapons you think would be cool for the player to find? Any sort of like vistas or moments for them to experience? Once all the leads are pretty much in agreement that, you know, yeah, we can get this done the time provided and it seems pretty intriguing and cool, then what we would do is we'd set up sort of an hour-long series of presentations for the entire team. Like, we'd all get them in the main conference room and go, you know what, for the next hour, we're going to explain this entire DLC to you, everything the players are going to find, all the characters are going to meet, what their motivations are, what the act structure is going to be like, what themes we're trying to drive home in the DLC, and then we'd record those. And what we would do is, if new people came on the project, all they would have to do is watch the orientation video and they'd get a sense for what the DLC was about. And also they could pass it off to a few people at Bethesda. So if they wanted to get a quick summary of what the DLC was about, they could just watch the video or, you know, actually just, you know, put it on play in the background while doing other things, just listen to what the DLC was about. So it seemed like a pretty good way of summarizing information. So that's just the first steps. Mm-hmm. Throughout the project, what you want to do after that point, though, is you want to kind of keep reinforcing what the theme is and actually make sure that, you know, it's all being carried through in the areas. And there's a few ways you do that. Because the leads are usually already on board with the overall direction, they'll actually, you know, keep driving that home with their individual team members. Like the art lead would bring home, you know, the environment art. We want Dead Money to feel like, you know, very claustrophobic, like make sure there's a lot of inclusion of the toxic cloud in certain areas. And they would help drive it home with the level artists. But the lead level designer would work with the actual individual area designers and like run through their levels, you know, at least once a week, and then with the entire team and get a sense for, you know, was the level hitting the right beats? Was the pacing good? Was, you know, the encounter mix good? Mm-hmm. And was it all basically reinforcing the direction that we got, that we had agreed upon? Mm-hmm. The best example of driving home the overall vision, though, was we had our third DLC was this one called Old World Blues. Mm-hmm. And what we ended up doing for that was we actually had sort of a Scrum system set up. And Scrum's sort of this subset of a management technique called Agile. We don't use the whole Agile process. We do use the daily Scrums, which is basically like 15 minutes of people meet in the morning, like all the team. They talk about what they're doing, any challenges they're having, if they're blocked on anything and need help to resolve that obstacle. And for Old World Blues, we actually took that as an opportunity to sort of showcase like little clips from 1950s sci-fi films that we were watching at the time and going, you know what? You know, in the brain from Planet Oros, which I was watching last night and crying while I was doing it, so it was so bad. But here are the following areas and creatures that I noticed in the film that I thought could relate to the following research center, or I thought it'd be cool to bring the theme in this way. And having those was just like a really quick 5-minute way to reinforce, hey, you know, we're trying to do the wacky science thing here, and here's a specific example of a movie in the 1950s that we think really hit the mark. So if you guys want to do an homage, please feel free. So that was just a few of the ways we do it.
Okay, so it's when does the real brainstorming and kind of all that inspiration, what part of the process does that really come from? And who's involved in that? How many people?
Generally, it's all the leads. We usually refer to that process as the pre-production period. What we want to make sure is like all the senior staff members who are in charge of the art, the animation. We even have the QA lead come in and be involved with like, you know, how we're going to be able to test all these things and what the scope management's going to be. Lead designer, the project director, all of those people basically kick around ideas within a series, I guess, of bookends, I guess is the best way to put it. Like, Bethesda and Obsidian had certain requirements for the DLCs, for example. Like, you know, we only want to shoot for like, you know, a 5 to 8 hour experience. You know, we only have a team of this size. And once you have those certain realities laid out to you, then you just sort of kick around brainstorming ideas within those parameters. So basically, the pre-production period can last 2 to 3 weeks or a month. It was pretty short for the DLCs. New Vegas was much, much longer. Mm-hmm. But once the pre-production period's over with, ideally, everyone wants to be decided on the direction, all the weapons you're going to request, all the armor you're going to request, all the levels we're going to request. And then you enter the production phase where all the leads gather the artists and the designers and go, okay, here's exactly what we're doing, go.
Cool. And so what kind of skills are required from a game designer? Should they have a background in, game development should they have a college degree in specifically game design? I mean, what skills are really required to be able to, you know, generate these ideas and communicate a creative vision to a team?
So in terms of college education, we don't care. I think the most important thing to me is when we look at applicants, we look for designers who would design games on their own time because they love doing it, and they're already out there doing it, and more importantly, finishing what they do. Like, so we look for modders. Like one of our premier area designers on New Vegas, we actually hired him because of the Oblivion mod he did, which got like 100,000 downloads. Like, obviously, he's out there, he's doing it because he enjoyed it. There was no recompensation for it. He just wanted to add that to Oblivion because he was really excited about doing that. Mm-hmm. And that's the kind of people we look for. Now, I'm not saying that we don't actually look for people like who have associate skill sets, like, you know, they have a good, you know, scripting background, they know how to program. They might have a sense of architecture, you know, some concepting background. All of that stuff is helpful and important, but overall, it's the drive to design stuff and the willingness just to put that extra effort to sort of increase the fun factor. That's the kind of stuff that we're looking for.
Okay. So what were the best parts of working on Fallout New Vegas, and what were the challenges?
So New Vegas was a little bit easier than some of our other RPG products just because we'd had the opportunity to try and do Fallout 3 back at Interplay. So we had a whole host of ideas still lingering in our head that we'd never actually been able to bring to fruition. Mm-hmm. But then New Vegas came along, and suddenly we were able to give that backlog of ideas sort of like a new scene and new environment to play out in. So that made things easier. The DLCs actually ended up being even easier than that because because they were so focused and were like, hey, it's only going to be this amount of play time, you only have X number of characters to play around with, that actually ended up being pretty freeing as well. We knew that because, you know, if you only have four characters in, you know, in our DLC, Dead Money, for example, we were able to make pretty reactive characters, but yet narrow the entire focus of the DLC. So you weren't like doing like for a cast of hundreds with really shallow interactions. You were able to make some really core, deep experiences with the characters in the game. And also because the environments were a lot more focused as well, the art team was able to spend more energy and more time in making each location sort of individual and unique, which was kind of nice. And I will say one other great thing about the DLCs is in our industry, we don't usually have any guarantee that we're going to be able to do a sequel to a game. So we were doing Knights of the Old Republic 2, for example, and we had a whole lot of foreshadowing elements for what could play out in Knights of the Old Republic 3, you know, like, you know, where you get to track down Revan, you know, he goes to fight the old Sith Lords. And we foreshadowed all that stuff in 2, but then 3 never was able to happen. So, like, you know, once the tears go away, you realize it's probably not the best thing to plan for in your titles. But because Bethesda committed to 4 narrative DLCs for New Vegas right up front, that gave us a huge opportunity to go, oh, well, you know, we can do 4 of these in a row. So rather than just do these isolated experiences, is there some way to share characters between them? Is there some way to tell like an overarching narrative across all 4 of those? And, you know, as a writer and a narrative designer, the ability to play around with foreshadowing was just really, really cool.
Yeah. And so you're talking a lot about DLC. In role-playing games as opposed to sometimes sequels, because that's hard to plan for. Mm-hmm. Do you feel as though DLC is going to be more of a major role in future role-playing games from Obsidian and from companies overall in the industry?
Most of the contracts that we've seen from publishers recently have pretty much guaranteed DLC plans built into them. So I think that the industry is gearing towards that model. And they seem to recognize the benefits of it. I think partly it's pragmatic in the sense that it causes people to hold on to the game longer and also allows for future additions that incorporate all that DLC content in. I will say, just from a design standpoint, the only thing I really care about is it gives us time to add more stories to the world, which is very, very cool. And usually what will happen is sometimes, like after a game is released, like the forum will start getting excited about certain elements of it, but then you can use DLC to help flesh that stuff out too. So like we were able to flesh out like the Legend of the Burned Man in New Vegas, for example, you know, answer a few of the fun questions that have been left over for the Mojave and ones that we'd purposely left in there. So I guess I'm just really happy because DLC just gives me more of a chance to tell short stories. So I'm like, yeah, sure, I'm there.
Yeah. And so how did you get involved in the industry? What was kind of your stepping point in?
Well, it was kind of filthy. I was doing pen and paper writing for Hero Games Champions line and their Dark Champions line, and I was getting paid like maybe $50 every 2 months. It was something that just also made me cry a lot. So eventually, I talked to my editor and go like, I've done these books. A steady paycheck would be nice. So if you happen to hear of any place that's actually hiring would still allow me to do writing on the side, I'd really appreciate it. And he knew the head of the D&D division at Interplay out in California. And he decided, you know what, I'll just send Chris Avellone's resume his way and just see if he's interested. And what I didn't know is that he'd actually passed my resume along in exchange for like $300 worth of software. So basically I got traded and whored out for $300 worth of games. And I actually got to see them passing the bag, wow, like back and forth, like during that hiring procedure. And I was just like, wow, I feel really, really dirty right now and excited at the same time. So but basically I started pen and paper gaming and then I got whored out for computer game design. But I have no regrets. It's been awesome.
Yeah. So how did your skills that you developed as a game master, how did that prepare you to work for Obsidian and Interplay?
Well, game mastering is kind of a brutal hobby. I think the biggest thing it teaches you is that you get immediate player reaction to things that you do as a game master at the table. And getting that immediate feedback for how your adventure is being paced, are they enjoying the loot, you know, the loot dumps that you're giving them, you know, are they enjoying the encounters, the NPCs you meet? Doing that for like about 8 years sort of trains you as to what players sort of expect in terms of having a fun time during the adventure. Also, because most role-playing games allow you to sort of customize your character builds, you have to plan an entire adventure for 4 to 6 people that might have wildly different skills and abilities. So And kind of an interesting twist, I actually ended up doing a Fallout pen and paper game. I actually ran like two simultaneous games at once to sort of get a feel for like, you know, how these two parties might interact in different parts of the world. And because Fallout allows you to do like, you know, here's the combat character, like, here's the stealth character, the guy more geared towards science and intelligence, and here's the charisma guy and the doctor. We had a whole range of different characters, so it became a challenge during that pen and paper session to go, you know what, I want each of these character builds to feel valued and appreciated during the adventure so the players feel really cool. And that ended up incorporating itself into a lot of the area design that I did as a game master. And I think that's also important as well.
And so that really kind of almost foreshadowed a lot of the elements that have, you know, that are involved in game design almost. I mean, would you say there's anything were there any surprises when you really started to design games?
In games, I think the only change that jumps out at me is in games you have to be a lot more specific in the details. Like when we're doing a pen and paper game, like I would draw out these really detailed maps, get a sense for you know what sort of loot tables would be like. But in the actual game design for computer games, like you have to be super specific about it, like an NPC's schedule, you know, exactly what they're carrying, exactly what all their attributes are, because all that stuff needs to be you know just interpreted as data. When you're doing a game mastering session, you can play a little bit more loose with some of those things and also sort of improv on the fly. In computer game design, you can't do that. Okay.
And so what other skills that you learned along the way, kind of in your education, in your childhood, helped you prepare to be a game designer? What other things were valuable on your way?
Well, one thing that was a detriment was the reason I got into gaming in the first place and writing in the first place is because I'm kind of a huge introvert. So like I would just spend a lot of time, you know, building out dungeons and adventures, you know, just because it's a much more isolated activity. That absolutely did not serve me very well once I got into game design. What we really look for is sort of extroverts and people who can communicate with the team. So it kind of took me a while to break out of that shell. It was worthwhile, but you know, it's still kind of a struggle today. Some of the skills that I think really paid off was. I got a minor in architecture at Virginia Tech, and the way they structured their program at that college is they have about 2 years right up front where they sort of teach you to break down your creative boxes in the sense of like they start making you question all your assumptions, kind of like throw them in the trash can, just create, and here's the tools that you can use to create, here's how you lay out 3D space, you know, here's how you guide people through the space. So basically the architecture degree helped a great deal with actual level design, and I still use that in level reviews today. Also, I had an English degree from William & Mary, and the amount of writing that they require that you do just nonstop, and then how brutal the teachers are when they actually critique your grammar, that also served me really well, just because so much of our goal, so much of our job as designers is doing technical documents, not having to worry so much about the actual grammar problems with your character, much more about the tone and the attitude. And also, when you're filing a bug report, being very clear and very specific about the steps to repro it and also how you fix the bug is also very important as well. So I think those two skills were helpful. I wish I'd known more about programming and knew a little bit more about 3D modeling, to be honest, but those two skills were definitely helpful in becoming a game designer.
And so what advice would you give students who are looking to get into the industry as a game designer specifically? What should they work on? Are there any things that they should do to prepare themselves?
Well, I guess there's a few things. One is I probably would not get involved with a game design program that doesn't have you interacting with a small team to generate a finished product. That's also what we look for when we're reviewing candidates at the studio. Like, you know, what's on your demo reel? Like, did you actually finish this game? What's the game like? How many people did you work with? Also, we look for people that, again, like basically design on their spare time because they love it. So that means like we look for modders, people who do their own multiplayer deathmatch maps. Like all those things show that they want to be involved with game design and they love it so much. They don't even care if they get paid for it. They just want to do it. And that's the kind of passion that we look for. Some other advice I'd probably offer is we really admire initiative and determination. So if you get turned down one place, like don't assume that it's all over for you at that point. Keep reapplying. Or if you got a test that was rejected, wait until another position opens up, apply again, show how much you've learned over time, and that also goes a long way to getting rehired at a studio. So that's probably some stuff I would offer.
Mm-hmm. And so what are the best parts of your job, what would you say?
Well, people bring in a lot of cupcakes and cookies and all sorts of other delicious stuff, so that's pretty cool. It's kind of cool, because like almost every other morning, someone will bring in like, you know, some sort of cake or something. You're just like, man, it's really great to work here. And also, I guess just from the office environment, you know, you can dress a lot more casually. Like just about everybody in the studio shares the same interests. You're usually playing the same games, you know, sometimes against each other. You know, lunch breaks, like it'll evolve into like Left 4 Dead matches and things like that. So those things, you know, give a really nice atmosphere to the workplace. It doesn't always feel like you're working at all. The interesting thing though is that I think when I talk to my friends who aren't in game development, they probably spend 40 hours a week at their job and then they can go home and sort of leave work at work. I've noticed that in game development, it's not that way. I'll usually find that I'll be working like 80-hour weeks because I love it, and there's always more that you can add to make it more fun. Like during the DLCs, for example, like it was like about, you know, 10 or 12-hour days, you know, plus weekends. But actually, you know, that was so much fun to do. I didn't mind doing that amount of work because, you know, you're basically getting paid to do your hobby. But I will say there's a huge discrepancy between, like, you know, the sort of more conventional workplaces where, you know, you can do your 40 hours and leave, versus game design where you can always do more to make the game better. So I think that's one difference I've noticed too.
So to backtrack kind of toward the design, how the design process works, how many people are involved or creating the main story arc of a game like Fallout New Vegas? And then, you know, what people are involved in the other, you know, side story missions?
Well, once we actually have the parameters for, like, what the scope of the project is going to be, like, you know, there has to be a signature city, you know, like Vegas, you know, somewhere in the game. Once you have sort of the big story points that the publisher wants you to hit, and you agree with those, after that point, there's usually one person who makes the decisions on the story. But they do the brainstorming session with everybody, they collate the ideas, and then they make the calls on various things. Go, you know what, there's going to be this number of factions, here's where they came from, you know, I like what you suggested, Travis, let's include an area like that over here. And they'll be responsible for the overall narrative arc of the game. And that's important, because you don't want to divide it amongst five or six people that all have equal say. You want one person who's making all the calls and reinforcing the theme and sort of maintaining consistency. And we have a position at Obsidian called the creative lead who does that. And they're responsible for making sure like all the characters, you know, are, you know, using the appropriate slang, like all the quests are structured the same way in presentation. Nothing seems jarring in terms of how factions are presented in one area versus another. And that usually all gets shaken out during pre-production. And then the consistency pass happens later on as a creative lead will review what area designers and other like narrative designers that report to them do. And just make sure that it's meeting the bar that they're looking for.
Okay. Well, that's all the time we have for today. Thanks for coming on the show.
Really, Anders, thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
For more news, reviews, and interviews, please visit facebook.com/gamecreatorsvault.